The views and opinions of this broadcast do not reflect the views and opinions of Armed Media, Unu Productions and its affiliates. Enjoy the show.
Good evening and welcome to the Leadership with Bianna Kovic Show. And thank you for being with us. Our topic, Leadership, focuses on leaders such as yourselves. We believe that leadership is a skill that can be learned through practice and awareness. Throughout the show, we will be talking about leadership traits such as generosity, curiosity, clarity, gratitude, approachability, humility, accountability, and many others, and how they help leaders become more effective when working with individuals, teams, or organizations. We hope that our conversation will help you become more reflective and effective when it comes to your own leadership practices and enable you to leave a positive legacy. Our very special guest is Camille Matthews. Camille is one of the top talent agents, celebrity management agents, and publicists. She is the CEO and the owner of the Selective Artist Agency and Promotimedia One. Camille's agency carries some of the biggest names in the music, sports, radio, book, and film industry. Her company is also involved with Film Production World and has been working with two film production companies, one in New York and one in LA. She holds a position at the Sundance Film Festival Celebrity Lounges, where she works closely with celebrities, setting interviews, booking talent, and dealing with integrated product, vendors, and sponsors, and engaging opportunities she values year in and year out. Camille believes in giving back and has been involved with several charities in and out of state of Utah. Camille, welcome to the show.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much. I'm very honored to be here.
Camille, you're the CEO of Selective Artist Agency, and I was wondering if you can tell us a little bit about your agency.
Our agency is an agency that is celebrity management, and we started about 5 years ago, and it covers the area of, and mostly celebrities and established, but actors, directors, producers, sports entertainment, speakers, and anything that's along the entertainment area right there, we pretty well cover, but mostly established people.
And how do you go about scouting your clients?
You know, a lot of agencies have to. We have never had to scout out our clients. They come to us. We usually get so many people reaching out to us that, and a lot of times, if they aren't established enough, we usually send them to three or four very well-respected agencies that we know of and tell them that this may be a better fit for them, at least temporarily. We mostly have celebrity management only. We aren't like a talent agency that goes and does a lot of extra work or does pictures and acting classes, anything. We don't do anything like that. Ours is literally only celebrity management, where the A or B list producers can reach out and they can automatically be fit in with bookings of that kind of stuff, where these producers have seen them on TV, where they've seen them in certain projects, and they can reach out to them literally in person by phone, and they can reach them and talk to them about that, about any project they want. And so it's a little more upscale project type thing, but they've reached that part in their life where they deserve that. And so that's where we are at. And so we're very selective about who we allow in our agency. We also have very high ethics, very high morals that we are adhere to. And we kind of expect whoever we have in the agency to kind of apply those same rules in their life as well.
And just so our audience know, you represent a variety of clients, from actors to broadcasters to sports people, right?
Yes, we do.
Mm-hmm. Yes. And I know that last time we spoke, you talked about movie projects that are coming up for you guys. Would you mind sharing that with us?
Yes, we've been working on a couple of different movie projects and a TV project that are all just about ready to be finished. We have a TV project that is just about to fruition called Vice Squad LA, and it's kind of like an NCIS that has about six different cities, and that one is just about finished, and it'll be getting ready to be filmed here in about 3-4 weeks or so, and we've been working with all the investors and the networks and stuff to get that one finished. We had a couple of films this week that actually got finished funding and the distribution and everything else. And they are actually going to be starting filming this week. So
that's very exciting. You must be very excited and proud of all these things that are happening.
We are. We get a lot of speakers that come to us and want to be a part of a speaking program. A lot of people with our athletes program and charities that want to reach out and be a part of that and help with those. And we're grateful for that. Christmas is coming up, and we always do a lot of work at Christmas with the charities and with our celebrities on board. They help us with that as well.
So talking about charities, again, we spoke a little bit prior to the show. I know that you volunteer with Soul Food Sunday as well as Salt Lake City Interfaith Homeless. Can you tell us a little bit more about those two volunteer opportunities that you do and what attracted you to them?
Well, there's three homeless charities out here, and I had some friends who told me I'd been helping take care of my mom, and I was her caregiver at the time as well as doing my work, and everybody felt I was burning the candle at both ends, and they said, you need to get out and do something for you and maybe enjoy with people your own age. And one of the places I noticed a lot of those people were working or enjoying was at the charities. And so I decided to go out to some of those because a lot of my friends that were in the industry were doing these. One of them was Soul Food Sunday, which a girlfriend of mine and her sister started years ago with their mother. And it started with just the three of them and starting some peanut butter sandwiches and taking to the homeless. And now it's grown into thousands and thousands of people and still doing the same thing. And they also have a big Christmas party. And my company's become involved in bringing gifts and Santa Claus and a big dinner with chili and everything else. I mean, it's become a big, huge party with all kinds of things. And Soul Food Sunday is also linked with another group called Care Cuts, which is kind of the same thing and some of the same people. And a couple times a year, they bring in beauticians and barbers and all kinds of people that will give haircuts. They line them up with clothing, try to find ways for these people to have housing or jobs or just different places they can go. They have a guy named Gil Ma there who has a little farm of animals that used to be abused, and he's taken them in, and they've all been now loved, and now they go to people like the homeless or something, and they try to heal through love. And they have horseback rides, and they have the sheep and the lambs and the goats and the bunnies, and the children get to hold these and play with these and have fun kind of like they would at the state fair while the parents are having haircuts and doing all these kinds of things and makeovers. And there's a DJ that plays music, and there's food. So it is kind of like a miniature thing of the state fair. And so they do that several times during the year and then have a big gathering and earn money, and the money that's earned is given again to the homeless charity. Mm-hmm. The Interfaith is done every Sunday, and they go and serve food out of a building there, and they are allowed to come in for 4 or 5 hours, and that's four different religions getting together, serving them food. And they have an area there where they can learn school, have tutors on computers. There's an area where there's a store for them to get stuff for free if they have found housing. There's an area there where if they have nothing, that there's barrels and they can have their picture taken and be given a number, and they can put their stuff in there while they go to look for jobs. And that's their temporary housing. But no matter what, these people are there to help them and see what they can do to better their lives and help them in the meantime. And for the Sunday while they're there having their food, there's a little church group, some music, and they get to come into a building instead of have to be outside like they used to. And they have a nice meal, and they can repeatedly go up and get food. And it's very nice. So all these charities go up and do this every time. My company now with ABC and the Toys for Tots and the Marines each year tries to collect from different vendors and different companies about $250,000 worth of stuff that we can give out to the homeless and to the women's shelters and things like that, so that they can all have a good Christmas or a better year between warm clothing, blankets, toys, things like that.
That is truly wonderful to hear. And I just want to talk a little bit more about another organization that you are supporting called Operation Underground Railroad. We chatted a little bit about it prior to the show, and I found it very interesting. Can you tell us a little bit more about that organization?
Yeah, I had a TV show of my own called In the Spotlight with Camille. We had a lot of celebrities or companies that, again, were very positive people and that had learned to get forward or get back into the community. And one of the groups that came on was Operation Underground Railroad, and they spoke to us. I'd also met them up at Sundance, where I had worked with several of our clients. And afterwards, after we had them on the show, I ended up helping them with the media for their new film. And then they have, of course, a ton of other amazing people that are volunteers, people that go out into the field, people that are there weekly to take care of all the things that need to happen. And for such a great cause, for children who've been kidnapped, sexually trafficked, and people that are going to go do this. And mm-hmm. this all started with one man who used to be with the FBI and decided that he needed to start a group like this to be able to get out there and be able to save some of these lives. And he put a group together that helped really be able to do that. And they have saved just hundreds of thousands of lives on this and done a beautiful job. So it's amazing.
And I know that you mentioned there was a movie on Sundance. Do you mind sharing a little bit more about that movie?
The movie, when they first made it, was actually put into the Larry H. Miller Cineplexes. Mm-hmm. And I believe on the very first night that it went in, it grossed over $600,000 just in one night. And all the money was actually donated to the Operation Underground Railroad to be able to help with going and saving these trafficking victims. And so it's the movie itself is not a fluff film. It's not a feel-good moment. It actually is one of those movies that shows exactly what is happening in the trafficking thing. It's like a true story type thing. And it's going to show you what goes on in the life of somebody who has gone through this. So when you walk in to see this, you're going to see what really happens, how scared they are, what they've gone through, what these traffickers do to these people, what's happened right down to when somebody, gets arrested and these people are rescued. So, I mean, it's really, again, not a happy or feel-good moment. It's a true life moment of what happens to people that are put into this situation. But it's a realistic moment. And it is something that happens every day that a lot of people don't even know about. Mm-hmm. And thank heaven that there's groups out there that fight against it.
And I assume that was a documentary, Camille, right?
Pretty much, yeah. It was a true story, yes.
True story, right. So circling back to your agency, I was just wondering, how did you go about starting it?
That happened because my whole family is in the industry, the television and movie industry. And I've worked in this industry since I was maybe 5 years old. I have a lot of contacts, and a lot of people in this industry probably like me more for my contacts than anything. And the people that work with TV and radio at one point started realizing they needed somebody who could be a union agency rather than just a talent agency, because the talent agencies could not help them further their careers in higher bookings, higher producers, anything they needed. And so it came to that point where they said, would you be willing to open an agency, a union agency? There were no union agencies in Utah. And it's kind of hard to find one that can go by the rules or that kind of thing that they can have. So I had to think on that, because if I did that, that also meant kind of quitting doing the stuff I loved or I liked. And I didn't realize how fast it would take off either. So I agreed to it, opened it, and said that I would help anybody at any of the TV stations, any of the radio stations. That at that time ended up skyrocketing, and meaning that I was going to help any of the sports guys, any of the sports athletes, any of the sports directors. It ended up doing stuff with the Olympics. We hadn't planned on any of that, but it all kind of leads into one thing. And when you're at the stations, it's not just the anchors or the others. It ends up being sports directors. The sports directors lead to a lot of the sports. The sports lead to this. And so we ended up doing a lot of things we hadn't planned on, along with just our regular actors and film and fashion week and all the other things we were doing. So we became busy very fast. And as you can see, with that kind of work, we didn't have to go out looking for people. We had more than our share of people and projects coming in and films coming in. And we didn't have to look for people. Actually, we had to turn down a lot of people.
And I know that you're also a producer of I Did It and You Can Do It, two speaker series. Can you talk to us a little bit more about that?
Yes. I Did It, You Can Do It Too is started as a celebrity speaking tour. And then we included a lot of other very established people in the community, because there's just so many well thought of people, whether they be in businesses, whether they be medical doctors, whether they just be some amazing teacher in the community that people can learn from. But we had heard a lot of young kids or people, you know, they'd see celebrities or they'd see other people, but young people nowadays that were maybe entitled or just millennials that would say, well, they did it, but just because they did it, you know, it's hard work and we'll never make it there. So we're not even going to try. Or they'd consider suicide or taking drugs. And so they gave up way too early and they would never even try. So we gathered this big group of really positive celebrities that had had really interesting stories ever since they were young. And we wanted them to understand, look, they didn't just become a celebrity or have a great job or have to do this. Some of these people, one of our bobsled guys, he actually grew up with a mom who was a drug addict. He was almost homeless. And if it hadn't been for the teachers teaching him with tutors, he would not have become the man he is today. I mean, they helped him until he became valedictorian of his school. He was offered 2 scholarships to several different Ivy League colleges. He became an engineer. And then after that, he was offered to join the Olympics, which he did. And he was with the bobsled team and got several different Olympic medals. They did documentaries on him. They did documentaries on his life. He did viewing parties, did all kinds of different things because of the story of his life. And then he became one of the vice presidents of the Utah Ballet. And then while he was doing that, again, the Olympics came back around, wanted to work with him. And now he's the president of the Utah chapter of the Olympics. And just as this last year, he was doing the viewing parties and different things while they were having the Olympics. And he just got inducted in the Utah Sports Hall of Fame.
That's amazing.
He's one of our clients.
That's pretty
I'm sure
amazing.
He wouldn't mind if we told that.
Yeah. And just so our audience know, you do not only have Utah clients, right? You're very nationwide.
That's right. We're nationwide and we also represent in Europe. Yeah.
Oh, great. Wow. So you're an international agency.
Yeah, we're international. Hmm. We represent nationwide and we have clients that are in England, Germany, France, Italy. Yeah. So we've had them call us from Turkey and from Greece that we are still looking into. But we have several different countries and we're one of the few places that is willing to represent internationally and has the contacts to do so.
That's very exciting. And just circling back to your speaker series, I actually looked into that because I was so impressed with the number of speakers that you have. So as you said, they are like folks from, they don't have to be celebrities per se, right?
They don't. Mm-hmm. They don't. And the good part is we made a program where they could come speak and it's very cheap. So really anybody can come to it, whether they're a kid, whether they're anything. And we had the speaking, there were speakers that would come and some of them would be like athletic that could come and do a thing where you worked out like at the gym. Others were dancers. So part of it was a speaking thing. And the other part was a thing where you'd work out. So the first day, maybe you were just listening. The second day was you were joining in and doing part of the thing with the speaker. There were raffles, there were signed gifts given away by celebrities, there were pictures, there was catered food, there were massages. I mean, we tried to really cater to them, and sometimes it was out of state. You know, I mean, we may be in a different state or a different university or maybe Hawaii 1 month doing something with one of the things down there that they do, but we trying to teach them, you know, look at fun things you can do. But what our main effort there was to try and voice positivity and to try to teach them, look, every single one of these guys has had to do something very negative from the time they were small, and yet they still grew up and had the life they have now. If they can do it, you can do it too. And we wanted to represent. You go to college, you get a scholarship, you get a grant, you pull through, and then you're going to be able to forward that to someone else. Mm-hmm. And through the talks we give and we get out there, we have fun. We've tried to do this, and then we try to film them. And then we try to also, we've told the MGM down in Vegas that we would give them copies of these that they can put out on the big screen after all the shootings that were down there so that people can see these for free whenever they want. So that this way there is a voice of positivity, people being able to see this and being able to come down and listen to speakers or have speakers go there so that they can get in tune and they can listen or they can be a part of it or they can speak, they can tell their story. But, you know, and some of these speakers have gotten involved and helped some of the athletic programs where they needed them or other charities. But this way, people are getting out there and helping each other and feeling good about it. And they may not have thought about it until after they got into this and listened to a speaker or became a speaker themselves. And they realized, you know what, if they can do it, I can do it too. Mm-hmm. I'm going to try it. But it has helped people. We've had people come to us and say, I was down at the bottom I was thinking of suicide. I had tried drugs. And because of that, they decided that they were going to get into a rehab center and they were going to try. So we know that this is a thing that has helped a lot of people. And even if it was just regular people that said, hey, you know what? We had a great time with this. It was a positive way to help us get through and just to have fun. We really enjoy these speakers. Those are great speakers. So the speaking form for us is kind of close to our heart because we feel that they're going out there and they're forwarding it in a way that their passion has helped other people now.
And it seems it's very close to your heart because I know at one point you actually were a TV host of In the Spotlight with Camille, which you actually mentioned, and the message was always positive. You wanted to show people like this is where you are, but this is where you can be. Can you tell us a little bit about that TV show that you had?
Yeah, when we started that show, that was the main idea behind it, was that we could, no matter who we put on the show, the idea was that they come from a positive way of life, and that no matter where they'd made it, whether they were a celebrity, whether they were an established company, whether it be a medical doctor that had somehow come up with something that was helping with some form of disease or something, but somewhere these businesses were forwarding something into the community, and it was always positive. I think we had one time where something was a little bit unhappy, but it still came out with a positive outcome. And these things, people loved it because they always came out with a good feeling. And, you know, for a show that normally is only around 20 minutes to 25 minutes, we always had such a good outcome with people saying, we love that. Can we be a part of this? Can we speak on the show? Can we do this? Can we tell you what we did to forward it to? And so people liked it because it had a positive outcome. And I think there's so many things nowadays that whether it be on the news or whether it be just something that's happening in the community, that it's so easy for those things to affect your lives, that when you can have something that is a positive outcome, it turns it around and it really affects their day because it's like, oh, I love to hear that because it's positive. So we've had a great amount of people who enjoy that.
And it seems to me it gives people hope.
Correct. Mm-hmm. Yes. A lot of hope.
Mm-hmm. So you're pretty broad in your expertise. You've done a lot of things. At one point, you were also standing for Debbie Reynolds' show. How do you evaluate your own success, Camille?
You know, my parents gave me great teachers, started me out, like I said, when I was very young, when I was about 5 years old, with piano lessons, dance lessons, private voice teachers. They let me get out there and perform with groups that were not only performing, but traveling nationwide. And they gave me that chance to do things that sometimes other parents didn't let you do. But it was the chance to be rejected or the chance to succeed. And so I got the chance to be with several groups that maybe other people wouldn't get the chance to do. And I got to get out there and sing and dance and enjoy, which was something I loved. And then when I was a little older, about 15, I had my first agent and I got to go out there with TV and film, which is, you know, I was enjoying myself. And by the time I was there in my late 20s or early 30s or somewhere around there, was about the time that I became a stand-in for Debbie Reynolds and started doing things with Barbara Hershey and Elaine Stritch and David Strathern and things, you know. But these were the kinds of things that I had been able to do because I had parents who were very open-minded and allowed me to have a regular job as well. And they wanted me to go to college and have knowledge, but they also wanted me to have the passion in my heart and be able to get out there and do the things I've loved. And so I did. And in doing that, I appreciate that because the things I've done were because my parents instilled that in me and allowed that for me. And so I always promised that if I could do that, I would turn around and forward that for other people when I saw the passion in their hearts. And so that's what I've done. You know, I feel like they may need to be to a certain area, but if they aren't really to my area, I know several other places that are to that area that they can work with their passion and eventually we'll pull them up to here anyway. So we want to help them. We want them to earn their passion and to be to where they want to be. We just need to do it in the right perspective. You know, if you need to start here and get to here, then come to us. Let's just do it in the right order and then get you there. We can do whatever we need to get you the place you need to be, but we will help you earn your passion.
So you mentioned, I just want to circle back. So you mentioned that your parents really gave you that freedom to really experience things and try things. Have you had role models besides your parents? Have you had people that sort of guided you and show you the steps how to go about it? Because you were in the movie business, you were an actor. Mm-hmm. Did you have anyone like that?
I was very fortunate. Like I said, I did dancing, I did film, I did theater. And here in Utah, there were a lot of them that were quite great that way. And I got to work with Lex D'Azevedo. I got to work with Marvin Payne. And here in Utah, Michael Flynn. Those were all people that very, very knowledgeable and very wonderful to work with. And I looked up to them because I knew I was going to not only have the pleasure of working with them, but that I was going to have the honor of learning knowledge from them. And so I got to work in several productions with all of these fine gentlemen. But I also, as I was getting older, had the honor of being able to work with people, as I said, like Debbie Reynolds, who not only was just in the show, but when we had free breaks, she would sit down with us and she would teach us knowledge. I mean, she was a very friendly lady, very friendly. And so she talked to us and she'd tell us straight up that, you know, I can't do a movie without everybody in this movie, right down to the extras, to the people doing lighting, to the people that are catering, to the directors and the producers. She said, I can't just walk out here and be Debbie Reynolds. If everybody isn't doing their part, this movie doesn't go on. She said, so it takes every single person in this movie to make me be this and for you guys to be you, because everybody is as special as somebody else, because this movie has to be all about everybody, not just me. And I remember looking at her and thinking, what a great thing to say and what a wonderful lady she was, because she made everybody feel so special. But she was right. She was absolutely right that every part is special and that you just need to work at whatever your part is that day and earn your way up to when you get to a part you want to be. And maybe you'll find you like a different part better. Maybe you'll find you like lighting. Maybe you'll find you like directing. But for whatever you do, you're going to learn a lot of knowledge in this industry, because it's a place where you never quit learning. And so you're going to learn a lot of different things in this industry, but you'll meet a lot of really wonderful people along the way. And so there's a lot of contacts, networking, and a lot of knowledge that you will learn. And so it's like a place of higher learning, like a college all along the way. And so you get to have a real inspirational joy along the way, I guess is how you would put it.
So what you're saying to us, you basically never stop learning.
You never will, not in this industry.
So it seems to me Debbie Reynolds was really inclusive leader. And my next question is, are there any traits that leader needs to have to be a truly successful leader in any industry?
I think that a true leader has got to be willing to be able to do anything they would ask of another person. I think they have got to have kindness, compassion, patience, and I think they've got to be very willing to remember what they went through and be able to instill those traits in whoever is trying to come through now, and understand that, you know, you were there once. So give them the ability to come through those things and remember where you were at that time, so that it's possible to help get them there. You've got to be able to do those kind of things in order to be a good leader, because at one point you were where they were.
So what you're saying to us, don't forget where you came from.
That's right. Don't forget where you came from.
So you wrote a piece on LinkedIn about staying true to yourself. And I think you titled it, There is no strategy. The best strategy is no strategy. Can you tell us a little bit more about that concept? Because most of us think that you have to strategize, you have to work, plan. You know, so how do you go about succeeding with no strategy?
Well, you know, I think everybody, well, not everybody, but I think a lot of people in the world get caught up in the idea of these wonderful jobs, these wonderful ideas, and then they get so organized and so list worthy of what they're going to do, an itinerary and everything else, that sometimes they forget that sometimes not everything has to be strategized. Not everything has to be put to a list. Or I'm not saying that you shouldn't be organized, but I am saying that sometimes you will forget the everyday happiness, the everyday sunshine, maybe the people around you that are even looking to you just for a smile. You may forget the happiness yourself, and you may not even stay you if you don't get out there and just remember what it took for you to get to be you. If you don't get out and keep doing the same things that you started with to stay where you are at the upper places you are now, you've got to be able to just not necessarily have any strategy, but be able to keep doing all of those things, but still continuing to go on and do the upper things as well. You've got to somehow be able to handle that full load in order to be a good leader, but still to be able to keep happiness and thoughtfulness and be able to multitask, I guess is the word. But I don't think that you necessarily always have to strategize, because strategizing, you may have to sometimes, but not always. Strategizing sometimes takes the fun or the happiness out of maybe being able to communicate very well with all of those people that you may need to, and you may not get to know them as well. You may not know what their needs are. You may not know what they need from you. If it's all just down on a paper and you say, here's the memo, let's all meet at this time. Okay, thank you and goodbye. And you may never know that person. But if you sit down on a one-to-one and you say, tell me a little bit about you. What can I do to make your day better? And then that person looks at you like, oh, they care. And you took time, even if it was only 5 minutes, to actually sit down with this person, to stare at them, to smile with them, and to listen. You took notes, and then you went about your day with whatever your tasks were. But you took that time, and it wasn't strategized. It wasn't this. And that way, it was something that affected the people you work with. Do you see what I'm saying?
So what you're saying to us, try to be versus try to plan what you need to do.
Yes. I think your actions say more than your words, pretty much.
Mm-hmm. So sometimes as leaders, we deal with uncertainties. You know, you can plan, but then the life happens. What strategies would you use when dealing with uncertainties that are coming your way?
There are going to be times that there are emergencies or there are things that funnel in that nobody planned on. And being a CEO or being the head of the company or a manager, you don't have any choice but to step in, put your foot down, make decisions, strategize. And those are the times that you have to know how to make all those decisions, delegate, put people in a place and say, here's what I'd like you to do. And that's when it was really good, maybe not to strategize as much earlier, because now these people want to work with you because they feel a kinship, they feel a friendship. And when you delegate to them, they don't feel like it's just some manager they hate and they can't stand to work with. They feel a kinship of a friend and a manager that they want to work with because they know that person wants to keep them safe. They know they're going to help. And so if that person says, look, this is an emergency, but I really need your help. Would you help me? They're going to want to reach out a little better and they'll do it. And if you're firm, but you're kind, they're going to step up and they're going to do their duty.
I guess some people would wonder, how do you delegate effectively? What would be the strategies to delegate effectively?
We found that the best way to delegate to people was by teaching them, you know, when they first came into the company, that every Monday we would have meetings. And then we would also tell them, if you have any questions, you can ask us. If not, try and be doing the things you should. If there's more questions, come to us, ask us. If not, we're going to have a person of the week or a person of the month that gets awarded for this. And we would have incentives that we gave away. And they were really nice. And we felt that if we had some incentive thing that really made them look forward to it, where it was such a hard work week and they had so much stress, that if there was some little thing that it gave them a reason to look forward to, plus, you know, maybe a bonus at the end of the year, this was their way of feeling like, wow, maybe they really care. You know, I mean, we also took time to sit down and talk with them and say, how was your work week? Did the work go okay? Are we overloading you? Do you need some help? What can we do to step in and help? Let us know. And then if there was something going wrong, then they were encouraged to be honest with us and tell us so that if it was, we could have somebody else step in to help. But we can't help them if they don't tell us. And then at that point, as long as everything was running smoothly, we could get everybody doing their job. Do you see what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm. So would you say that every leader is also a good manager?
Yes, I think for the most part it is. I was the type that would be willing to go in and clean bathrooms with the janitor as well as do my job because I don't feel like they need to feel I'm any better than they are. As long as the job gets done, it's just important that we all work together. But if we're in an emergency situation, I obviously need to be doing my job because I'm the only one trained to do that at that point. And at that point, everybody needs to be doing the job they're delegated to do.
And what are your thoughts on generosity and leadership?
You know, I've given talks on this about leadership and servitude and generosity. And I believe that you're a better leader when you can bring generosity or servitude into others' lives. I believe it makes you a stronger and better person and maybe more focused and maybe stronger in your way of thinking. And I believe that it helps the others that surround you and they feel that and they want to work around you better because they can feel the kindness, the generosity, and the servitude coming from you. And they have a faith or a hope that things are going to work out well because they feel that coming from you. So I do believe that it kind of goes in a circle. And I believe that it's a very strong and healing type of hopeful type mm-hmm. of leadership.
Interesting. So generosity goes a long way, what you're saying to us.
Absolutely.
And you've been the person that's been reinventing yourself quite a lot. You know, you had a TV show, you started your own mm-hmm. agency. Why do you think that being open to reinvention is so important?
I think if you quit trying to invent yourself or learn, it's just like when you quit reading or when you quit doing at any point in life, you know, like an older person, they quit trying and they sit in a chair and just watch TV and it's about that point they die. You've got to keep trying. You've got to try new things. You've got to learn new things. And as long as you do and have bucket lists and you get out there and you're willing to learn and you have that want, then you will be healthy and your brain will be healthy and you will be able to continue on and share that with others as well. And you'll be able to carry on in your life with this. The minute you start giving up on that, everything in your life will start to go downhill and you won't be able to do as well. It carries on from one end of your body to the other. So I believe it's very important to keep learning.
Hmm. So what you're saying to us, actually learning can in some respects slow down the aging too.
It does. In aging and physical and in your personality on whether you're positive or start feeling depressed.
And any suggestions for folks who might be, you know, they might want to try reinventing and trying new things and they might think this is what I want to do, but they do not get support from their family or their communities. How do you start reinventing yourself if you have to do it on your own?
Well, you know, I would tell them to look at certain things that they really like a lot, you know, kind of say, maybe write a list and say, these are the things I like most, you know, maybe a young lady likes music and she can do it well. Maybe she can play the piano. Maybe she likes fashion. Maybe she's gone through school and she's really good at English. You know, so she writes down those things. Maybe there's a young man who is very good at cars, or maybe he can draw, or maybe he just happens to be very good at engineering. But these are things that whatever it is that he's very good at, you know, these are things that only he sees, or maybe he's good at surfing. I don't know, whatever it happens to be. But maybe these are things that these two kids only see, and their parents are just saying, you know what, you need to be realistic. You need to have a job that pays lots of money. So don't think of these things. Well, even if they have a real job, I do think it's a good idea that, because some of those jobs can pay really well too. I think what you need to do is network and talk to outside sources. They have places all the time that have networking parties, that have job fairs. And there's no reason you can't talk to other people and say, I have an interest here, even if it's a part-time job, or even if it's something that I could talk to you about or be an intern for, or at least see it. Maybe I won't like it, but maybe I would. And you'll never know unless you go and see it. You know, maybe you could try to build something, a prototype or something, and see if you were good at it, or draw some dresses and see if you'd be good enough at design to enter it in something. You know, if you could try these things and just check it out, then at least you would never feel like you didn't try. Mm-hmm. And, you know, there's always people from businesses or around you networking that if you ask them, whether it be from TV, radio, magazines, all over the place, that if you ask them, they'd be more than willing to give you a contact or say, you know what, you're really good. Let me put you on TV, or let me show you, let's give you the right contact. And they will help you and show you the right direction, the right road to say, I think you ought to talk to this person. And if you need to be there, they'll help you. If not, they'll say, you know, this, what you might be really good at is graphic artistry, you know, and maybe that was something they didn't even think of.
So what you're saying to us, be curious, allow people to possibly guide you, give you suggestions, and open-minded. Be open. Because that's how you and I connected. We connected on LinkedIn.
Correct.
Yeah.
So definitely get on LinkedIn.
Yeah, definitely get on LinkedIn.
Good business venue.
Yeah. So I guess this leads me to my next question. How does clarity and curiosity impacts leadership?
You know, I think that curiosity is a really good thing for anybody to have. I think without curiosity, you can only go so far in life. And I think that you have to have a curiosity about so many different areas in life, and you have to be able to get out there and search out, you know, write your several lists of bucket lists of things you want to do from the time you're 20 to the time you're 60, and what in all aspects of life, maybe things you want to do in business, things you want to do in your personal life, maybe things you want to see your kids do or your friends do, but just things that, and they may never happen, but they won't if you don't write a list. They say it's more likely to happen if you write it down and you can check it off. So these are things that you may really want to do, you know, and some may not be as much, but you've got to have that curiosity, that interesting thing in life that says, I want to go up in a balloon in the sky. You know, I want to go play golf at the Masters. I want to do all these different things, but you know, and you may never do those, but you definitely aren't going to do it if you don't have it on a piece of paper where you can mark it off. I think there's got to be the curiosity. There's got to be the follow through. And you've got to have the clarity in mind, the focus. I think it's good if people can get up in the morning and maybe have meditation, maybe go walking, go to the gym or something before they ever start work, so that their work day starts out with a focused mind, a lot of clarity, so that when they do, they are very clear on what people are asking them. And the meetings become very clear to everybody on what everybody's saying, very focused, and they will think better. They'll feel better. Their personality will be better if they do those things throughout the day, if they're able to feel good on those kinds of things.
So what you're saying to us, you have to be mindful.
Very mindful, very aware.
Mm-hmm. So one of your skills is marketing strategy. Can you tell us why is that so important in today's world?
You know, there are a lot of people that have gone into marketing nowadays. I'm not sure that all of them necessarily know what they want or what kind, to be honest, but they have seen that it's interesting. And there are so many forms of marketing, again, that you kind of, it's like the list, like I said, you have to have an idea of what you want to do. Are you going to do PR? Are you going to do advertising? Are you going to go to B2Bs? Are you going to work in TV? Are you going to do digital? What are you absolutely going to do in marketing? Pin it down. Say, this is what I'm good at. So you really need to talk to yourself and say, what am I the best at? And you've got to be willing to know what you're good at and what you're not, what your strength is and what it's not. And for those that are better at it, let them take over. And for the places that you have a strength, take over there, because, you know, that's the best way to do it. A good leader always understands where they are not strong, and they let somebody else take over. And then they will work somewhere where they know their strength lies. And that's the best thing to do, because you see the strength in other people and you allow them to learn, you allow them to build their strengths, and for others to address them and say, wow, you are really great. And you allow them to get on with their lives doing the things that they are meant to do. And if you're not good at that, you know, let them work with you, let them do it. You're both winning.
So include others, recognize where your strengths are and where your weaknesses are, and allow others to step in and do their job and contribute.
Correct. Forbes 500 says that having a strong team is the best thing you can do. Trying to do it alone will never win. But if you build a strong team and a team full of others that all have all these different amazing attributes, but you're all in different areas, you will have a Forbes 500 winning team.
Interesting. So circling back on marketing strategies, how do you know that your marketing strategy is hitting the home run? And if it's not, do you suggest that you should actually change the strategy?
That's an interesting question. I think the way you know that you're doing good is when your work continues, and maybe you're getting overly slammed with a lot of work. But then again, even if you're doing that, that doesn't mean you're always going to win. I'm thinking of one time when I was working for ABC with Janine Golightly, and we were bringing in we had one particular place that we'd worked on for at least a year, a huge, huge conglomerate. And we just kept going back. We kept bringing them into ABC for meetings, and we kept doing these things. And they kept saying, you bet, we're going to do this. And we'd get a little flustered. And we had really worked hard on this one. And we had brought in several others in the meantime, thinking, okay. And we thought, how come these ones are so easy? I think otherwise we would have gave up and just thought we were really awful at our job. But in the meantime, this one just, you know, was playing it hard to get. And we couldn't figure out why, because they were worth millions and millions. And these others were much smaller. And yet we brought them in. And this one just kept playing hard to get. It really, really kept us humble. Because we realize that sometimes you've got to have a lot of faith in God, and you've got to really understand that you've got to know where He wants your journey to go, or maybe that's not exactly the place that you were even meant to be. Maybe that's not the right puzzle piece. Maybe you wanted it because it was worth a lot of money, but maybe there's somewhere else that you're supposed to be horning in on, and you're supposed to be saying, that company over there needs me more than this company does. Mm-hmm. And once you actually go over there, because you're feeling it, you go there and sure enough, they needed you, and boom. So you've got to be very aware of where the needs are supposed to be for both companies, not just you, for both companies, and work with them. Mm-hmm. And it's got to be a two-way street. If it's not, it's just not going to work.
Interesting. It's so funny because you actually mentioned the word humble. And, you know, I was going to ask you a question about how do you stay humble while you're working with teams, while you are leading others. So can you add more to it? Or
I think that if you don't stay humble, Heavenly Father will help you become humble quite easily. You know, if you bring an ego or anything into the workplace, you may be all right for a little while. But between people or businesses or things around you, if you don't have kindness, compassion, faith, gratefulness towards God, it's not going to last very long. And that humbleness, if there's no humbleness, you'll get torn down right to the very bottom. And eventually you'll have to have humbleness in order to be brought back up. You have to have the right things in your life in order to be able to be good at anything you do. And one of them is a realization that anything you are is because of God. He allowed you to have this in the first place. He made you what you are. You have to have faith and hope that you can do anything that He is allowing you to do, and that you will be good at it if you have faith in that. You've got to go out and treat others as you'd want them to treat you. And you've got to go out and work on something that you know you're good at with teammates, that's something they're excellent at. And as a team, purport that and say, okay, where do we go? Which ones need us the most? And then you just go out and you pitch the best possible package you possibly can, knowing that there's going to be other people pitching, but you go out with the biggest red bow, the best pitch ever, and you do it with a smile and a happy thing, knowing that if people see this, they're going to love it and going to want you to go away. And, you know, there could be 100 pitches in there, but if you do the best, yours is going to be the one that wins.
And I really like that you talked about gratitude, about being aware that, you know, there is maybe a higher power also helping out along the way.
Mm-hmm. A couple of years ago, I went to the Utah Film Awards, and we had a lot of A and B listers from California and New York that were out there. And we were probably out of all the award shows you'll ever see on earth, whether it be the Oscars, the Tonys, the Grammys, anything, you know, they'll go up and they'll accept their award, thank the directors, the producers, everybody that was in their cast, and say, thank you. I'm very grateful to accept this award. But you don't ever see what you saw at this one. They'll go up and they'll be very thankful for that. But every single one that had gone up there, including the ones from Germany and everywhere else that had got them and that had been nominated for the Oscars, every single one of them said they were very grateful to God for the fact they received this award. And then they thanked their director, the producer, and their families. And not a one didn't. I had John Schneider sitting behind me, and he was just flabbergasted. He said, I have been to the Oscars. I have been to so many award shows, but I have never, ever been to one where everybody thanked God. Hmm. He said, that is amazing and special. He was right. I mean, how often is that going to be seen in a lifetime? It was amazing. And that's how it should have been, because all these people had done a beautiful, amazing, and talented thing in their life, but they were grateful not to, just to the other people they'd worked with. They thanked God for the gifts and the talents they'd been given to even start this out in the first place. That's where they were grateful, in the right place.
And just so you know, our audience understand that God can be higher power. It doesn't have to be God per se.
No, it can be anything. Yeah. No, you're right. Because everybody has a different belief system, mm-hmm. of what that is, you know, and a different religion, or maybe not even a religion. It could be anything of what they think higher power is. But for whatever their belief system is, you know, they can be thankful to that.
And I think what you're trying to say is that it's very important to include that in your daily practice, to be thankful and Absolutely. To realize that it's not only you doing it.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
So you mentioned Grammys, you mentioned Oscars, and that leads me to my next question, which is, how does feedback from media about your work, about your films, about your clients, how does that impact your leadership style?
Well, I work with the media a lot. So if anything, it has made me be more aware of what is going to be seen in the media and how very careful you have to be of what people think of the media or say of the media, and how careful you've got to be of what people think of you, your projects, the other things. So I've had to be very careful sometimes about what I will say or do around my project or around media, or maybe even voicing an opinion on something somebody would say, maybe something I feel strongly about. But even if I work with media on something like that, I won't say anything, because they normally tell us, do not get involved. You have to keep very nonchalant on this one. You can't do that, because media just doesn't get involved. And so I have to be very careful on those kinds of things. And it's hard sometimes, because so I have learned to be able to keep quieter on some things. I've also learned that there are some things that if it's an important issue to me or an important project, that maybe I don't bring as much attention to the media. And if I do, I let somebody else do it, because this is something that's important to me. I let this be more of something that is a personal matter to me with my heart. And I let somebody else cover that, because if I'm taking time to cover that, I'm not going to be putting the attention into it that's in my heart. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. So what you're saying to us, you have to know yourself and the way you communicate so that you can possibly ask someone else to step in, so the message Correct. Will be clearer when it's delivered mm-hmm. to the media.
Correct.
Mm-hmm. That's very interesting. You know, so I was going to ask you, what are your thoughts on being assertive when you're leading others or when you're talking to media? But I think you kind of answered that question, but I was wondering if you can add something to it. Do you think being assertive is good? Do you think it helps you?
I think you can be a leader in two ways. I think you can still be a leader in the media by things you say, but I also think you can be a leader by the things you don't say, by showing people by your manners or the way you act. I think there's a lot of respect involved in that. And I think that people will watch your mannerisms and think, you know, that person's been doing this for 35 years and look what they did. And they will notice that. Mm-hmm. And all of a sudden they'll start saying, I want to be more like that person. You know what? If they aren't doing it, I don't want to do it either. And it becomes a part of their lifestyle, because they know the respect involved. They know the level of where they want to reach. And so they start saying, maybe I need to do this too. Maybe I was wrong. And so they start copying manners of leadership that this person may have done. Now, there may be other times where it's something that is such a strong issue that you have to speak out on. So you have to pick your words very carefully, and you have to edit things, and you have to say, okay, if I have to speak on it, what would I do and how respectful do I need to be in order to get this out for people to understand, but maybe not say anything that would scare people, hurt people, or and yet be so respectful that I can still be a leader among people, get them out there, keep them safe, and yet make them happy enough to know that I was out there to do that for them. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I mean, it's very interesting what you're saying to us. Communication is the key. Mm-hmm. Also, being transparent is the key, but you got to be very careful about your transparency. You have to be mindful what kind of message mm-hmm. you're sending out.
Very mindful of words. Mm-hmm. Words can be issued, and sometimes you can never take them back.
That's true. I agree with that. Any difficult part of being a leader?
You know, there's a lot of difficult parts of being a leader. When people work under people, you know, they're going to come in and work and they're going to go home that night. And they may think their day was hard, but a leader is going to do that job and they're going to take care of all those people, and they're going to have other projects, and they're going to deal with maybe the media or with companies or other things. And they're still going to have to take care of all those people that they had at work that day, plus payroll, plus all the bills. So you've got a lot of stress involved that a lot of other people don't think of. And you've still got to come back the next day and be happy and take care of them and their incentives and your own personal life on top of that, whatever that may be. So it becomes a very hard job as a leader, but you either need to know you can take it on, that you're strong, or if not, then you've got to put somebody there that can take that on. And so being a leader is not all it's cracked up to be. You know, if this job is not your dream job, if you have not wanted it since you were 5 years old, if it's not in your heart, if you have not dreamed of it and said, oh my goodness, I just have to do this. I've just got to try it. I would love it if I was never paid, then you don't need to do it, because you will be so, so disappointed when you have to work 12, 14, 20 hour days and you're not working with A-listers and you're not getting the pay you wanted. And you may hurt because you've worked so long and it became a big disappointment. For somebody who loves it, they're going to love it regardless of what they did. They could have been on there with fun people, or they could have been doing this and they were just on a set, so they don't even care. But if you were only there for the wrong reasons, you will never be happy.
And I think in particular, that's true for the industry that you're in. Mm-hmm. Because you're putting your heart and soul into it.
That's correct.
So what is your leadership style like?
My leadership style is I try to include everybody in our meetings. I want them to voice their opinions. Like I said, we have Monday morning meetings. I don't feel like I'm any better than any of them because I work with such a great group of people and I want to learn from them, to be honest. And they all come from different areas here, like directors, producers, sports, TV, media, medical areas. So I have a lot to learn from a lot of people. So I just look at it like a lot of colleagues. And so I look at it like we work together as a team, and I want people to say, you know, I need to learn this because I've got a meeting next week. Could everybody kind of chip in and help me on this? Or hey, in sports this week, it's getting over drilled. We've got this, this, and this going on. Could anybody help us with this? Because so-and-so called about the NFL, but they need a guy that is going to be able to help out at one of the tents the day before the Super Bowl, and their company is going to be a part of it, but they need somebody who is very knowledgeable on the NFL. And so they come in with all kinds of different questions that they have, or maybe it's something with movie and TV, but we have to be ready to be able to answer any kind of question, you know, whether it's TV, movie, or any of those, or maybe it's about one of our speaking things and people that have called in and said, hey, could you come speak here? Could you come speak here? Is your calendar full? And so these are all things that we have to do. And I want to feel that I'm just one of those people that's just there helping answer questions like they are. I don't want them to feel like I am overriding them or doing anything else, because a lot of times they have better answers or better questions than I ever will.
And any suggestions for women leaders?
Yes, I've noticed there are a lot of women out there that have been trying to get out there and do businesses, go to college and have a lot of great strength and really very brilliant people. Not that the men aren't just wonderful and great too, but I think there's always been men out there working. And so there's not been a lot of notice on women really performing or doing it. And now that the women are getting out there and doing it, it's just so amazing and wonderful to see the brilliance and the strength and the wonderful things that they've been able to do. I've met some amazing women. I met Jen Welter, who is the only women's NFL coach and who writes books and does some amazing, wonderful things. I've met a lot of other women with strengths through different things they've done. And I look at this and I just think to myself, you know, years ago, there wouldn't even have been an area for this, because it usually was just that women got married, had children, and they were moms. And now it's become an area where parents pretty well guide their kids and say, everybody needs to go to college. Everybody needs to get a job. And so by grace of God, women and men have gone to college, and women are seeing that they are just as good, sometimes better at some of these things. And I think it's wonderful that we have so many women that are coming up in these areas, and actually that a lot of men are revering them and giving them credit and saying, good for you. I'm very proud of the men for that, because they, you know, they're not coming down on them or feeling that. They're actually, you know, clapping and saying, good for you. We're glad to see you can do that.
And that's very important, because it does show equality.
It does. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And what is your mission in life?
You know, my vision in life is to be able to follow through. You know, I would have thought at one time it was only film and television the way I was going, but I've had such a broad retrospective of things I've been able to do that at this point, like I said, everybody should have bucket lists. And so at this point, I want to kind of go through and try all those little things I've put on bucket lists, whether it's for work, personal, or anything else. And I want to just follow through and keep learning and trying all those things to go about as high as I can in business. I want to, with those things, however high I go or learn from, I also want to forward back to other companies or other people. And I definitely want to give back to as many charities as I can from that.
And how can people learn about your company?
They can go to Facebook and they can look up Selective Artists Agency. They can go to our website at ididityoucandoitto.com. They can call us at our phone number, which is 801-960-0851. We have an email, which is Selective Artists, the artist is plural, so Selective Artists Agency at gmail.com. And for right now, that's about what we've got. We have another website, but it's being fixed right now to put a lot of media kits, a lot of information with a lot of our celebrities in it. So it's not quite finished yet, but when it is, it's going to look amazing.
So they should keep Selective Artists in mind and just keep looking forward to that website, right?
They should, because that one will be for Selective Artists to continue. We had so many other artists that came in that we started doing that because, like I said, we've got national art. We do have one other artist that just came on, and he wouldn't mind me telling about him. That's Clinny Jackson, and he taught Michael Jackson how to do the moonwalk. He's written himself a book at this point. He's done a lot of other things. He's done a lot of other shows and stuff since then, and we just got him onto a new TV show. They're also thinking of doing a reality show where there's a lot of the dancers from the shows back then that they bring on to do now, and then try to give those dancers a chance to have a scholarship to one of the colleges.
So show business and giving back.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Very nice. Yeah. Well, thank you so much, Camille, for being a guest on the show.
Well, thank you. Thank you. Very honored. I appreciate the chance.
Our guest tonight was Camille Matthews, the CEO and the owner of the Selective Artist Agency and Promoter Media One, the producer of the national speaking tour and retreat, I Did It, You Can Do It Too. And with that, thank you for tuning in and listening to the Leadership with Vianna Kovic show. Please remember that you're all leaders in your own right, and that the impact that you're meant to achieve starts with small acts of kindness, curiosity, and generosity. If you like the show, please follow me on Twitter, Facebook, LinkedIn, or Instagram. You can also listen to the past episodes and subscribe to my Leadership with Vianna Kovic YouTube channel. I wish you a wonderful evening. Until next time, thank you again and have a great night.